Hi, I'm Matt Harrison, and I'm excited to show you how you can speed up your time series code with no code changes. I wrote the book Effective Pullers, and I'm going to take some examples from that book and show you how you can speed up your code using NVIDIA's accelerator. I'm going to show you how to install this, and then I'm going to run a time series analysis using the CPU, and then I'll repeat it on the GPU. So installation is pretty straightforward. The main thing is you want to make sure that you have a GPU. So if you're on Google Colab, you'll want to come up here and make sure that you have the correct runtime type. I'm using L4, so that has a GPU and I'm good to go here. You can run this command and it will just verify that you are in a good place. You can see that I have NVIDIA L4. So I should be good to go as far as hardware. I do need to install some software. Luckily, that's really straightforward. I'm going to use UV, which I'm preferring to use these days because it's super fast. And I just need to say extra index URL and say pullers and then GPU in square brackets and say QDF pullers CU12 as well. And you can see that this installed very quickly here. I'm really happy that NVIDIA took the time to make this work with UV. In the past, getting these sorts of things installed has been more of a handful, and this is really easy. It takes a few seconds to install this. Okay, let's load our data here. I'm going to load a stock data set. Okay, and let's load pullers. You can see that I'm using pullers 114 here. Let's load up my data. I'm going to use scan parquet. If you're not familiar with the scan functions in pullers, the scan functions are lazy, and you're going to want to use lazy functions where possible. That's going to allow you to get the most speed up. If we look at the data frame, we see that there isn't a data frame, or rather we see a query plan. That's what happens when you have a lazy data frame. In order to get access to the data, we need to run this collect call here. So let's do that and see how big it is. We've got 36 million rows of data. Okay, so the next thing I want to do is just check the types, make sure I know what's going on in there. And so I'll just pull off the first 10 rows of data to see what I have. It looks like we've got dates and we've got open, high, low, close, volume, and ticker symbols. So this is stock data. And there's also an index level over here. Presumably this came from a pandas export, and Pullers doesn't have an index, but it was in the data, so it's reading that there. I might want to look at the D types as well. Note that the D types are actually listed up here in pullers, unlike pandas. But if we want to explicitly look at them, we can just say D types here. So we've got two integers, a date time, some floats, and a string. Okay, I think our data is actually in a good place. We're going to start doing some of these aggregations. So the first aggregation I'm going to do is this one right here. I've written a chain of operations here. If you're not familiar with this concept of chaining, it's something that's super important when you're working with pullers. The reason is that pullers has a query engine and it can be smart and speed up the operations when it's lazy. And so if you've got some operation down below, like a filter, it can actually know when it's reading from the parquet file to filter rows or columns based on that. So it can do things very quickly. So here's our chain. I'm going to take my lazy data frame, and this line says I'm going to convert the date time column to a year column. And then I'm going to group by year. I'm going to aggregate all the numeric columns using the numeric selector from the selector module. And then I'm going to take the mean of those. And finally, I'm going to call collect. So the query planner will choose the best way to do that and then give me the results of that. Okay, here's the results right here. Now note I am using the cell magic time up above, and it says that this took 731 milliseconds. Also note that this is running on the CPU right now. This is just normal pullers code running on the CPU. Later on, we'll run it on the GPU. Another thing to note is that over here, we grouped by the year, but the year is not in sorted order. That might be confusing. Why isn't it sorted? And this is one of the things that makes Polars really nice compared to, say, Pandas, is that Polars is able to basically run things in parallel. And so it knows you want to group by year. So it says, okay, we're going to run all of these aggregations in parallel. And it's just going to get back the results and stick them in a data frame. In Pandas, it's not that smart. And so it would do these in serial order and take a lot longer. But a drawback of that is that Polars doesn't know that the years need to be sorted. It just gives you back the data frame with the years in the order that they completed. In fact, if you run it again, you'll see that the order of this is different. The years come back in a different order. Okay, let's do our next aggregation here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to create my year column again, and then I'm going to group by two columns. I'm going to group by ticker and year, and then we'll just take the mean for every ticker for each year. Let's run that. And here's the result of that. Again, if you were to run this multiple times, you would get rows back in a different order. So just be aware of that. That's one of the prices that you pay for getting that speed up from Polars. Okay, so to get around that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a sort right here. Let's run that. And if you look at this, it's taking about the same time, a little bit longer to sort that data afterward. So there is a penalty for sorting, but I'll live with that because I want to have the data in this order. Okay, let's run our next cell here. And I'm going to use a feature of Polars called Group by Dynamic. If you're familiar with Pandas, this is one of the really nice features of Pandas and Polars, is that you can say, I want to group by a date column, but I don't want to group just by year. I want to specify a, say, every 3 months or every 2 weeks or every 3 days. And both Pandas and Polars allow you to do that. To do that in Polars, we use the group by dynamic. If you set the date time to sorted here, what it will do is it will be smart and know that we should preserve that ordering here. So that's a way to get around one of your sorting issues. Now let's look at the group by. The group by says, I am going to use date time as an index column. Know that Polars doesn't have a notion of an index column. This is, I think, came out from looking at Pandas. Pandas has an index column, but that's the thing you want to group by, and it's going to be on the left-hand side when you run this code. Also know that there's this every, and this is where the magic happens. We don't have to make a year column. We can just say every 1 year. I can change this to say every 2 years and get the aggregations of every 2 years. So this is super powerful and useful. And then I'm going to say group by ticker as well. So this allows me to do basically a double grouping. I'm going to group by every year and group by ticker. So we're going to see on the left-hand side, we have ticker, and then we have every year inside of that. We're going to take the mean, and we're going to collect that. That takes like 1.3 seconds to run here. Okay, let's assume that I want to take two stocks and compare their performance, see how they're doing. That's what I'm going to walk through next. Okay, here's our code. Let's read through the chain. It says I'm going to make a column called year and another column called month. And then I'm going to group by ticker year and month. And I'm going to pull off all the max values for that. And then I'm going to sort ticker year and month. That takes 2.28 seconds to run. And we get back 130,000 rows when we do that. So we have in here for every ticker, we have the years and the months aggregated. This is great. I have the data aggregated, but I want to compare two different stocks. Generally, what I would do at that point is to do what's called a pivot, where we take the two stocks that we want to compare and we pull them up. They're in a column here, and we're going to pull them up and put those two stocks into their own column and then put the values for them for each year and month for those two stocks in a column. So that makes it really easy to compare them. We can do that with Polars as well. We're going to do our aggregation. So this is what we had up above. And then we're just going to say pivot. Again, this is using the terminology index. Again, index does not exist in Polars, but that's going to be the leftmost column. And we're going to keep the date in the leftmost column. And then we are going to pivot on ticker. So what that means when you pivot on the ticker column, is it's going to pull out that column and make the values from the column now column headers. And then what's it going to put in the values there? That's this next thing here. That's the close values. So when we run this, we can see on the left-hand side, this quote index, we have the date. Again, it's not an index. It's just a normal column. Polars does not have indexes. And then along the top, we have all of the ticker symbols. And we have the closing values for those. So if I wanted to compare two stocks, this is really easy. Now I just pull off the two stock columns that I want to compare. Okay, so I've got the data in this format here where each column represents a ticker. That's great for doing comparisons, but it's actually not the best way. I actually prefer to visualize things when I can. We can see things a lot quicker when we visualize them. So I'm going to visualize this and let's take two stocks and visualize them. Now, normally, if you're using something like Pandas and Matplotlib, you would keep the data in this format. However, if you are using Polars, it does have support for a plotting tool called Altair, and Altair has the ability to essentially pivot inside of it. So I can remove this pivot here and just say, I want to plot a line. In the x-axis, I want the date, and in the y, I want the close, and I want to color this based on ticker. And up here, I'm going to filter by Amazon and Apple. So again, this is the nice thing about using that lazy data frame is that we are scanning this pretty large Parquet file, right? It's got 30 million rows, and we don't have to read in all the rows because we're filtering them for certain tickers and it knows that it can filter out only the rows that it needs. Okay, let's run this and see what happens. And here we go. We get a little plot here that compares Apple to Amazon over this time period. Okay, so that was an example that was inspired by my book, and it's a very common operation that I would do for time series analysis. Now what I want to do is show you how easy it is to speed up this code with the accelerator. Okay, again, make sure you have that GPU runtime enabled here. And again, I have this L4, you can see up here that I have that, and it says the GPU here. So all I have to do is change my collect and say engine is GPU. And when I do that, I get the exact same results, but I get them much quicker. We can look up above. Let's see what this T81 ran in on the CPU. It ran in 689 milliseconds. We ran in half the time on the GPU. This might not seem like a huge win, 600 milliseconds versus 300 milliseconds, but when you get bigger data sets, you're going to see bigger wins. Also note that if you were to run this in Pandas, this would take probably on the order of a few seconds to run. So you're basically getting almost instantaneous feedback here with, again, the code is the same. We're just changing that collect and saying run it on the GPU instead. Okay, here's the next code that I ran, grouping by two. You can see ticker and year. And again, the only difference here is I said run this on the GPU. And there we go. It runs twice as fast on the GPU. Let's do this next one. It's just adding some sorting here. When you run that, we get that it runs really fast as well. Okay, now I'm going to run this group by dynamic. Let's run this here. When we run this, this is actually about the same amount of time it took on the CPU. So you might think, what's going on here? Well, what's going on is that the accelerator is in a beta state right now. So while the people at NVIDIA have been hard at work at it, they have not implemented all of the features of Polar. So the group by dynamic is not implemented yet. However, note that this still executed. It just executed on the CPU instead of the GPU. Your code isn't going to break, but if it doesn't speed up, it should run at the same speed that it would otherwise. I will note that I took this code and ran it doing something very similar in pandas. This code took about 24 seconds to run in pandas and is taking like 1.3 on the CPU here. A lot of people ask me, should I move to polars from pandas? That's a complicated question, but a general rule of thumb is that if you are doing a lot of group buys, that's where you're going to see the biggest speed up moving to polars. Another thing that you can do if you want to know what's running on the GPU and what's running on the CPU, you can change the collect call to say this right here. And what this is going to do is this will error out if the code doesn't run on the GPU, and you can see that this says it's not implemented. Dynamic group by is not yet implemented on the GPU. Okay, let's run our next query here. This is TA5. And this is the one that has grouping by ticker year and month. I actually get around a 7x speed up when I run this. So it's super fast on the GPU. And let's do TA6. TA6 was where we pivoted. Now, one thing to know about pivoting is that pivoting can't work on a lazy data frame. So it's a little bit harder to accelerate. The reason being is that if you think about what pivoting is doing, it has to know what is in a column to make the new columns. And if you're lazy, you don't know what the values in the columns are. You know that there are columns, but you don't know the values. So certain operations don't run on a lazy data frame, and pivoting is one of them. The workaround is we call collect before we do the pivot. That materializes it into a non-lazy data frame, and at that point, we can pivot the data. Let's run that, and the code works here as well. So this is the code that's ready for comparisons. It's got ticker symbols in the columns. Finally, let's do TA7, which is the plotting. And again, the only change here is this GPU, and the plot works here. I hope you can see that it's really easy to accelerate your code. All you have to do is follow the installation instructions, which again, super easy using UV. Super fast, and then you change your collect and you just say, I want to run this on the GPU. No other changes, super simple. And you get, in my case, I saw up to 7x speed up by doing that. And again, this is a smaller data set. If you get larger data sets, you're probably going to see bigger speed ups. Collected the results here in a data frame. And here's a plot showing the timings on the CPU and on the GPU. You can see that for almost everything, we're getting a pretty big speed up. There are two of these where we're not getting a speed up. One is the dynamic group by, and the other one is the pivoting. And then I've got another chart here just showing what the speed up is. So here we have a 7x speed up, but a lot of these are 2 to 3x speed ups. Thanks for watching. I hope you found this useful. In conclusion, Polars is fast. Polars Accelerator by NVIDIA makes it even faster. It's easy to install. It's easy to use. I get fast speed ups from using it. And if I was using a larger data set, I'd see even bigger speed ups. If you want to learn more about me or learn more about Polars, you can check out my book or follow me on social. Have a great day. Bye.